Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible, and if you'd care to, we're going to pick it up today. 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 14. And as we left off in our last lesson, the son of Jeroboam had become quite ill. And Jeroboam had his wife dress up as another and sent her to Shiloh, the home of Ahijah, the prophet, and to seek what would be the outcome for the lad who was sick. And God, of course, told Ahijah what was going on. He had become blind in his old age and said, this woman coming to see you is the wife of Jeroboam, and she's trying to fool you and me, the Lord speaking. Well, when Jeroboam's wife came in to the prophet, he asked her, you know, why are you pretending to be someone else, you wife of Jeroboam? And I've got some bad news for you. The lad is going to die as soon as you set foot back in the residence. And not only that, but the house of Jeroboam, his long line succession to the throne of Israel, if he had done things God's way, was going to be cut off because of his idolatry. And not only his idolatry, but he led the nation into idolatry as well. Sure enough, Jeroboam's wife, as soon as she set foot in the door, the lad passed away. And he was the last one, or the only one, of Jeroboam's house who would receive a decent burial, because as verse 13 stated, there was some good thing found in him by our Heavenly Father. So with that introduction, let's things start happening pretty fast here. So gonna have to have you stay alert. And you know, we've been spending several days on one king, Solomon, for example. We had the first 11 chapters basically concerning Solomon. And now things start happening a lot faster. We start going through the kings of Israel and Judah much more quickly. So we're going to have to stay alert. Let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 14, and it reads, moreover, the Lord shall raise him up a king over Israel, who shall cut off the house of Jeroboam that day. But what? Even now. And this last just doesn't quite carry into the English. This last phrase means even now the Lord is raising up one to replace Jeroboam. And Jeroboam still has a son alive, and he will reign for a very short period of time. But the Lord is already raising up Baasha to become the next king of Israel after Jeroboam and his one son when their reign is done. It's a done deal. It's going to happen, is what this means. Verse 15, for the Lord shall smite Israel as a reed is shaken in the water. No stability, in other words. And he shall root up Israel out of this good land, the land that flowed with milk and honey, the promised land, which he gave to their fathers, and shall scatter them beyond the river, because they have made their groves, this is Asherim in the Hebrew plural, provoking the Lord to anger. And when you provoke the Lord to anger, you can expect divine judgment. And judgment is being passed. And, you know, what did Israel do that deserved this? Well, they followed Jeroboam. He led them into idolatry. They followed. If you are going to follow a person, you might want to make sure that person is going where you want to go, because Jeroboam's leading them down the wrong path. You know, Moses warned Israel in Deuteronomy chapter 29, verses 26 through 28, that if you don't do things God's way, God will scatter you from one end of the earth to the other. Joshua warned them the same thing in his last parting words to Israel, Joshua 23, verses 15 and 16. If you don't do things God's way, he will scatter you from one end of the earth to the other. Beyond the river here, of course, is talking about the Euphrates River. The Euphrates River, always symbolic of the border between Israel and Babylon. Babylon meaning confusion. And the 10 tribes would go into captivity eventually to the Assyrians, and then they would go north across the Caucasus Mountains, inhabiting Europe and many later migrating on to the United States and Canada. The children of Israel are definitely confused at this time. Most haven't a clue of their heritage. Verse 16, "And he shall give Israel up because of the sins of Jeroboam, who did sin and who made Israel to sin." They followed him, and they're just as guilty as Jeroboam. You go into idolatry, you have no right to expect God's blessings. Verse 17, "And Jeroboam's wife arose and departed and came to Tirzah." Tirzah would become the capital of Israel under Baasha. "And when she came to the threshold of the door, the child died." This is Abiah. And the prophecy of Ahiah, the prophecy given to Ahiah by our Heavenly Father, had come to pass. Didn't take long. "And they buried him, and all Israel mourned for him, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by the hand of his servant Ahiah the prophet." His word always comes to pass. Verse 13 of this same chapter has been fulfilled. Verse 19, "And the rest of the acts of Jeroboam, how he warred and how he reigned, behold, they are written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Israel." And you can read about that in 2 Chronicles chapter 13. The hostilities, it never did break out into war while Rehoboam, the king of Judah, was still alive. But they had border skirmishes almost continually between Jeroboam's people and Rehoboam's people. All that war would come after Rehoboam passed away and Abijam, Rehoboam's son, took the throne of Judah. "And the days which Jeroboam reigned were 2 and 20 years, 22. And he slept with his fathers, he died. And Nadab, his son, reigned in his stead." Nadab won't be king for very long of Israel. Now, the number 22, first of all, in biblical numerics is disorganization and disintegration. The number 22 is associated here with Jeroboam, and it's also associated with Ahab, arguably two of the worst kings of Israel. Ahab, the one who was married to Jezebel, of course. 2 Chronicles chapter 13, verse 20, we learned that it doesn't say how Jeroboam died here, but we learned it in 2 Chronicles 13, 20. "The Lord struck him down, and he died." Verse 21, now we switch gears back to, we've been talking about Jeroboam, the king of Israel. Now switch gears and we go back to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, king of Judah. We'll see how things are going in Judah. "And Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, reigned in Judah. Rehoboam was 41 years old when he began to reign. Remember, Solomon was only 19 or 20 when Rehoboam was born. So Rehoboam probably one of the longest heir apparents recorded in the Bible. He was 41 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city which the Lord did choose out of all the tribes of Israel to put his name there. And his mother's name was Naamah, an Ammonitess. And an Ammonite, most of you know that Ammon and Moab were the sons of Lot, Lot being the nephew of Abraham. Thus, we're talking about Adamic peoples. But they did not worship Yahweh. Solomon married this Ammonitess, and no doubt she brought her gods with her, small g, and that's what seduced Solomon into committing idolatry, was his love of the women, and he started worshiping their gods. Rehoboam is going to take a lot after his mother. We see here too the mother of the king mentioned by name, and each successive king of Judah, the mother will be mentioned. A few of the kings of Israel, their mother is mentioned, but not anywhere near as many as of Judah. 22. And Judah did evil in the sight of the Lord, and they provoked him to jealousy with their sins which they had committed, above or more than all that their fathers had done. They were playing church and inventing a new religion as well. We learn in 2 Chronicles chapter 11, verse 17, that Rehoboam actually did fairly good his first 3 years, but then things started going downhill. Verse 23, for they, referring to Judah, also built them high places and images and groves, Asherah, on every high hill and under every green tree, the word every emphasizing that they were very, very numerous. They were all over the place. Heathen worship, verse 24. And there were also Sodomites in the land. Check this out in your Strong's Concordance. The Sodomites were male prostitutes. And they did according to all the abomination of the nations which the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. This referring to the Canaanites who were the occupants of the land of Canaan, the promised land before Israel crossed the Jordan and took over. Now, do you think blessings were about to come upon Judah for their actions? I sure don't. Verse 25. And it came to pass in the fifth year of King Rehoboam that Shishak, king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem. And we learn in 2 Chronicles chapter 12 that before he came up against Jerusalem, he took all of the fenced cities. That's the larger fortified cities, cities large enough to have a wall around them is what fenced means. He took them. They were under his control. In 2 Chronicles 12, we learn that Shishak, his army, consisted of 1,200 chariots, 60,000 horsemen, that's cavalry, and an innumerable foot soldiers, including Lubims, Sukkims, and Ethiopians, who were their allies, all hungry for the spoils of war. God sent a prophet by the name of Shemaiah to Rehoboam and told him the word of the Lord, you have forsaken me, the Lord speaking, therefore have I left you into the hand of Shishak. Shishak's not coming for a pleasant visit as the queen of Sheba did with Rehoboam's father Solomon. Verse 26, And he took away the treasures of the house of the Lord, which that would be considerable in itself, and the treasures of the king's house. He even took away all, and he took away all the shields of gold which Solomon had made. Those targets, the 300 targets that Solomon made, they were overlaid with gold and taken out of the house of the forest of Lebanon on special occasions. They were no more to be used. You know, and it's written in the Chronicles that Rehoboam and the people of Judah repented just as Shishak came their way. And for that reason, God caused Shishak to pull back. He didn't wipe out the entire population of Judah and Benjamin. He just helped himself to all the gold and silver that was in the treasures. And King Rehoboam made in their stead brazen or brass shields and committed them under the hands of the chief of the guard, which kept the door of the king's house. Not enough gold left or riches left to replace the shields that Solomon had made with real gold. They had to throttle back and go with brass. This word guard in the Hebrew is runners, but if they were actually guards, you'd have to wonder where they were when Shishak and his men were helping themselves to the treasures of the king's house and the house of God. Verse 28, and it was so when the king went into the house of the Lord that the guard bare them and brought them back into the guard chamber. They didn't keep them in the house of the forest of Lebanon anymore, but in the guard chamber. And we see in this that Rehoboam liked a lot of pomp and circumstance. Everyone look, we're pulling out the 300 brass shields, and Rehoboam is going up to church. Verse 29. Now the rest of the acts of Rehoboam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? In 2 Chronicles chapter 12, they sure are. Verse 30, and there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all their days. Now, this does not mean all and out war. As I said earlier, this simply means that there were hostilities, little skirmishes here and little skirmishes there. Usually the aggressor is listed first in God's word when a war is discussed. So evidently Rehoboam was probably the aggressor more than Jeroboam. Verse 31, and Rehoboam slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Naamah, the Ammonitess, and Abijam, his son, reigned in his stead. Abijam, if you translate, means father or worshiper of Yah. Well, will he be a worshiper of Yah, or will he worship the idols that his father Rehoboam worshiped for most of his reign as king? Let's find out. Chapter 15, verse 1. Now in the 18th year of King Jeroboam, now we back up in time a little bit, and don't get confused. Jeroboam passed away in our previous chapter. Now we're backing up to where he still has 4 years left in his reign. In the 18th year of King Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, reigned Abijam over Judah, and he's called Abijah in the Chronicles, so don't let that throw you either. Again, 4 years left in Jeroboam's reign, and fact is Jeroboam outlives Abijam, as we'll see. Verse 2. 3 years reigned he in Jerusalem. You see, Jeroboam had 4 years left to go, and fact is Abijam only reigned for 2 years in some months. He didn't actually reign for a full 3 years. reigned he in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. Abishalom, a couple letters added there, that's the same as Absalom, the son of David. And Maacah actually was the granddaughter of Absalom, not the daughter. In the Hebrew language, there is no word for grandfather or grandson, grandmother or granddaughter. Verse 3, and he, Abijam, walked in all the sins of his father, Rehoboam, which he had done before him, and his heart was not perfect. This means his heart wasn't completely with the Lord, with the Lord his God, as the heart of David his father. Verse 4, nevertheless, for David's sake, did the Lord his God give him a lamp. This is a term peculiar to David and his house, his descendants, in Jerusalem, to set up his son, that being Asa, after him, and to establish Jerusalem. And of course, the lamp would lead eventually to a descendant of David that was promised in the book of Samuel, that being Messiah, who declared himself as the light of the world in the New Testament, Yeshua Messiah. Verse 5, because David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, and turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save only the matter of Uriah the Hittite. And here again we see all the kings of Judah compared to their ancestor David as far as their faithfulness to our Heavenly Father. And of course, the except for the matter with Uriah the Hittite, you all know 2 Samuel chapter 11, where David was staying at home, probably a little bit too much spare time on his hands, while Joab and the armies of Israel were off to war, including Uriah the Hittite. Well, David saw Uriah's wife, Bathsheba, taking a bath, and he liked what he saw, and he had her summoned. He had an adulterous affair with her, and a child resulted. Well, what happened? David summoned Uriah on the feigning that he wanted to know how things were going with the war, but his purpose was to get Uriah back in Jerusalem and to sleep with his wife so that it would cover up his adulterous affair. It'd be hard to explain a child when he's been off to war for a year or a year and a half. Well, what happened? Uriah refused to go into his wife while his men were still in the field at war in tents. And David sent Uriah with his own death sentence and a note to Joab to send Uriah to the hottest front where he would be killed. How did God feel about that? Well, God sent a prophet to David in 2 Kings chapter 12 and said, you murdered Uriah the Hittite. But as far as his loyalty to God, it was unshakable. David, I'm speaking of. Verse 6, and there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all the days of his life. Now this kind of is out of place here and makes it even more complicated to keep up with who is king of Israel and who's king of Judah at the time. Rehoboam passed away in chapter 14 as well, and we're bringing him back up, but that's because it's tied into the next verse. Let's go ahead and cover it and I'll explain. Verse 7, now the rest of the acts of Abijam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And there was war between Abijam and Jeroboam. Now that's when the hostilities turned into actual war. And it was quite a victory for Judah under Abijam. Abijam and the troops of Judah and Benjamin numbered some 400,000. And the armies of Israel were 800,000. Judah was outnumbered 2-1. But and you can read about this in 2 Chronicles chapter 13. But Abijam gave quite a speech to the Israelites as before that war took place. He said, yeah, you know, you've got twice as many soldiers as we do, but you also have two golden calves that are your gods. You have priests who are not of the Levitical priesthood, who are your priests. You celebrate a festival in the eighth month that's not appointed by our Heavenly Father. And God gave Judah the victory. In fact, Israel lost. It was a thumping of the gourd in the first class. 500,000 of Israel were killed, and more than half of their army wiped out during that war. Verse 8, and Abijam slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David, and Asa his son reigned in his stead. Asa, finally, we're going to have a righteous king of Judah. The Smith's Bible Dictionary states that Asa, the name means physician or cure. Would he be the cure for Judah's problems? Verse 9. And in the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah. So we see Jeroboam not only outlived Rehoboam, he outlived Rehoboam's son, Abijam. About the same time, Nadab took over as king of Israel, back in chapter 14, verse 20. 2 years left in Jeroboam's life, but at that point, I think he became probably incapable of running the government, and Nadab, became king about the same time as Asa. Nadab, the king of Israel at this time, Asa, the king over Judah. Verse 10, and 41 years reigned he in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. Now that sounds familiar, like what we read in an earlier verse, verse 3, I think it was, of this same chapter. And critics will point out, well, this points out a mistake in the Bible. That's not a mistake in the Bible. And what happened was Asa's mother passed away when he was very young, and therefore his grandmother, Maacah, the daughter of Absalom, inherited the office of queen mother. Verse 11, and Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. And there would be some 10 years of peace after the death of Abijam. And Abijam did a lot to fortify the cities of Judah, and so did Asa. And after the fortified cities, God gave them the victory. We'll see over a million Ethiopians and Cushites during the reign of Asa. Verse 12, and he took away the Sodomites, the male prostitutes, out of the land, and removed all the idols that his father had made. He's cleaning house, doing well. And also Maacah, his mother, actually his grandmother, even her he removed from being queen mother, because she had made an idol in a grove, and Asa destroyed her idol and burned it by the brook Kidron. In the book of Chronicles, we learn that the Asherah she had made, it's called there a monstrous Asherah. Verse 14, but the high places were not removed. Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect or complete or whole with the Lord all his days. Now these high places were utilized to worship Yahweh, but they were still illegal places of worship. Why? Because God said, I put my name on the house, the temple in Jerusalem. That's where you come to offer sacrifice. Verse 16, and there was war between Asa and Baasha, king of Israel, all their days. The feud between Israel and Judah continues on. Baasha, the third king of Israel, but he's not of the seed line of Jeroboam. Verse 17, and Baasha, king of Israel, went up against Judah and built or fortified Ramah, that he might not suffer any to go out or come in to Asa, king of Judah. Now, Ramah was located in Benjamin and was actually very close to Jerusalem, several miles north of Jerusalem. And what Baasha was trying to do was cut off communications between the north, where the 10 tribes of Israel were located, and Jerusalem. Verse 18, then Asa took all the silver and the gold that were left after Shishak took most of it, in the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house, and delivered them into the hand of his servants. And King Asa sent them to Ben-Hadad, the son of Tabrimmon, the son of Hezion, king of Syria, that dwelt at Damascus, saying, now here we see one negative thing about Asa. After all the good he did in eliminating the idolatry, here is he depending on God? No, he's going to hire the king of Syria to help him. Verse 19, there is a league, an agreement or a covenant between me and thee, and between my father and thy father. Behold, I have sent unto thee a present of silver and gold. Come and break the league, the covenant, with Baasha, king of Israel, that he may depart from me. Baasha is busy building and fortifying Ramah. I guess Asa looks out and thinks that he's preparing to destroy or make war against Jerusalem, and therefore he's hiring the king of Syria. Evidently he's paying the king of Syria, Ben-Hadad, more than what Baasha had paid him, because we're going to see that Ben-Hadad listens to Asa and comes to the aid of Judah. But again, negative thing about Asa, he's not depending on the Lord to deliver him from Baasha. He's depending on Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria. Well, how will this all turn out? Don't miss the next lecture. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravett, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to leave to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We teach God's word in a positive manner. Throwing out negative about others serves no purpose. We won't do it. We'll let God's word do the teaching, the correcting, and the healing. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that can't use the 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? You don't need a telephone number. We can do away with it. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you 24/7. I encourage you to talk to your Heavenly Father. How do you do that? You talk to Him through prayer. That's a telephone line, basically, that the more you use it, the less it costs you. I'm talking about Judgment Day. So talk to your Heavenly Father. Let Him know you love Him. And, you know, we all fall short. Repent of your sins. We come to you united as one, Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, illnesses in the congregation, Father. We ask you to watch over, guide, direct, and we lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world, Father. We ask a touch of healing, if it is your will, and forgiveness and comfort for all others. In Jesus' precious name, amen, and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions and see what's on the mind of folks. First up today, we have Barbara in Florida. And Barbara asks, you talk about the time Mary conceived Jesus and the time of Jesus' birth. Was he conceived in December and born in September? Yes, you've got it right. And, you know, by understanding the courses of the priest, particularly the eighth course of the priest known as Abia, we can determine the actual conception date of John the Baptist. We know that he was 6 months older than Christ, so therefore we can determine the conception date and birth date of Christ as well. We're in that season now where we will be airing the Christmas program several times over the next several days. So if you can catch that program, it goes into the course of Abia and the actual conception date and birth date of Christ. Or if you choose, you could order the CD 30517, which is entitled Christmas. Betty in North Carolina, has the devil been cast out of heaven yet? Nope, not yet. He's still there, but you know his spirit is free, and those who serve him, the evil spirits, are free to come and go on earth, but he will not be on earth de jure until Michael boots him out of heaven. And you can read about that in Revelation chapter 12, verse 6, and the following verses. And you will know when that happens. Why? Because he's going to be sitting down in Jerusalem claiming to be Jesus Christ. You need to understand the false Christ comes first. Many are going to be deceived. Brian in South Carolina, how do I explain Mark 14:62 when Christ says that you will see him coming in the clouds of glory, seated at the right hand of power to those who believe in the rapture? This always seems to be their go-to verse. Thank you and God bless you. Well, in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1, we learn that a cloud has a different meaning than nimulus and the other kinds of clouds that we see in the sky. A cloud can also is a figure of speech that means a whole bunch of them. Like there was a cloud of locusts. There was a bunch of them. You know, of course, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17 is the rapture is go-to scripture as well. And it states there that we'll be caught up with them in the clouds. And again, there's going to be a bunch of witnesses caught up in a cloud, meaning a number of them. Mary in Michigan, is it true that when the soul returns to our Father, it goes through a burning cleansing, in parentheses, as a baptism? If so, where can I find this in the letter? It's not biblical. When the sixth and seventh trump is sounded, will they be heard on earth? Trumps are events, things that are going to happen before Christ returns. He tells us about those things in Matthew 24 and Mark 13. And your final question, does the letter explain why some die tragically and why is death painful to most? No, the letter doesn't explain that. And I would mention one scripture though, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, and that is, there's nothing that's going to happen to you that's not common to man, that has happened to others. And God will never allow you to be tempted above what you're able to handle without providing you a way out. Scott in Texas, will marrying someone who has been married before send my soul to hell? Well, you didn't tell me what ended the previous marriage. You know, there are biblically legal reasons for divorce. Many people don't know that, but there are. Irregardless, adultery, which is what most people point to and say you're doing if you remarry, if your spouse is still living, is the unforgivable sin. Adultery is not the unforgivable sin. And if the spouse repented and was forgiven, there is no adultery at all. John chapter 8, verse 1, and the following verses. Christ forgave the woman who was caught in the act of adultery. And once that sin's forgiven, it's gone. It's blotted out forever. Gloria in New Jersey. Will we see our loved ones in heaven if they are saved or not? Either way, you will see them and you will know who they are. Ezekiel chapter 44, verse 25, and the following verses document that. And let me kind of explain, that is in the millennium. And the Zadok, God's elect, have the right to go into the millennial temple with Christ. And they can leave the temple to go and help one of their relatives, mother, father, brother, sister, who wasn't married yet, outside of the temple that didn't make the first resurrection, and in an effort to help them. There's a price to pay, and the point is they'd have to be able to know them to go to them, obviously. So there is a price to pay, though, a seven-day cleansing period. Why? Because they will have been in contact with the dead, not physically dead, spiritually dead. Don in Virginia, I know we're posturing for the sixth trump, but shouldn't we wait for the, I think that's HS, meaning capital HS, meaning Holy Spirit, to speak through us at any time we may be brought up to any synagogue of Satan, that is to say the Inquisition or even ISIS or ISIL if one is captured? Well, you know, the Holy Spirit is not going to speak through God's election until they are delivered up to the synagogue of Satan, which is the church of Antichrist in Jerusalem. Doesn't have anything to do with ISIS or ISIL. Those are particularly evil forms of leadership that need to be wiped out, stamped out. I did a message at Passover this last year concerning Jihad Johnny, and that, you know, you can't negotiate with those people who want to kill you, and that we have to stamp ISIS and ISIL out. Has nothing to do with the return of the Antichrist, though. The Holy Spirit will speak through you when Antichrist is here on earth, not before. Robert in Kansas, I hear that the altars in the Holy Land are being rebuilt. What does this have to do with the end times? Nothing. You know, as far as we're concerned, we don't offer sacrifice to God. The sacrifice for one and all time was Jesus Christ. Hebrews chapter 9, you need to read and understand. We don't need any altars in Jerusalem. The thing that God wants now, the offering that he wants, is our love. Sharon in Texas, in the tomb where Jesus was laid after being hung on the cross and the third day resurrected, where can I read about the cloth that was left in the tomb? You can't read about it in God's word. It's not biblical. Now, tradition has it that the Shroud of Turin, which it's referred to, is still existent, but it's not biblical. Jeannie in North Carolina, please tell me again where it is, don't teach my children to fly. I have a New King James Version Bible. Wrong one, right? Right, you got the wrong one. You need a King James Version Bible, and you'll read about that scripture that you're talking about in Ezekiel chapter 13, verses 18 and the following verses. And we have Lee in Georgia. I've been studying with you for 5 years. We're glad you enjoy studying the Word. Someone stated in church that Leah and Rachel were twins. I've read the book of Genesis more than 13 times with your dad. He didn't say this. Are they twins? I don't believe they were twins. In Genesis 29, verse 16, it states that Laban had two daughters. The elder was Leah, and the younger was Rachel. Now, there are instances where twins were born, and the first one to be born is called the elder, and the other, but I don't believe so. They could be twins, but I don't think so. In verse 17, it goes on to say that Leah was tender-eyed, and Rachel was beautiful. So if they were twins, they weren't identical twins, but I don't think there's enough there to say that they were twins. Yolanda in California, I really do enjoy your Bible teaching. I have really learned a lot about the Bible from watching your programs. We're glad you're enjoying and learning. My question, how do you seek the kingdom of God? God's kingdom is in heaven. So how do you seek it on earth? Thank you very much, and God bless you, and God bless you as well. You know, and it states in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, that you should first seek the kingdom of God. You know, our goal as Christians is to join Jesus and our Father in heaven if we should pass away before the kingdom is here on earth. You see, in the eternity, the kingdom of God will be here on earth. But what Jesus was seeking, encouraging us to do in saying, seek ye the kingdom of God, was do what's necessary and following God's commandments and to make it to the kingdom of God. That's what the encouragement is. David from Georgia, I am writing to try to find out how many Bibles you teach out of when you do your Bible study for the TV broadcast. Well, I teach from the identical Bible every day. It's the same identical Bible that Pastor Arnold Murray taught from, and for that matter, David Murray. My mother, many years ago, bought three Bibles that were identical and gave one to my father, Arnold, one to my brother, David, and one to myself. Now, as far as, you know, preparation for teaching the Word, I use many Bibles and different reference works that you can obtain from our library here at the chapel. The main thing that people need is a Strong's Concordance, and having a King James Version Bible, you can check out the original languages, and oftentimes it adds a lot of meaning. I'll leave it at that. Bobby in Georgia. I have a question. Where in the Bible does it tell how many times you can repent? Peter asked Jesus in Matthew chapter 18, verse 21, in the following verses. And he asked Jesus, he said, how oft should I forgive my brother who trespasses against me? Seven times? And Jesus goes on to say in verse 22, not seven times, seven times 70 times. That's 490 times. And if we're encouraged to forgive those who trespass against us that many times, you can bet God will forgive you that many times. And Jose in Minnesota, how far apart did Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel live from each other? Well, all lived within approximately a 200-year period of time. Isaiah was the oldest or the furthest back in time, the 649 B.C., Jeremiah approximately 518 B.C., Ezekiel in the 400 B.C.s, and Daniel in the 400 B.C.s as well. John in Utah, what is the correct way to say grace and companion in Hebrew? Well, grace, as translated from the Old Testament, is from the Hebrew word kane, phonetically spelled out K-H-A-N-E. Companion, the word does not appear in the Old Testament. It does appear in the New Testament, the word companion does, and it's synergos in the Greek language. Lisa from California, my pastor often speaks in tongues, and I don't know what she is saying. I asked her one time what she was saying, and she told me that she doesn't know, and that it is the Holy Spirit speaking through her. Is this true, and can anybody talk in tongues today in the flesh? Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and the following verses is what people who do what your pastor is doing are think that they're imitating. Unfortunately, that's what they're doing. They're imitating because, and how do I know they're imitating? Because you can't understand it, and she doesn't even know what she is speaking. That's not what happened in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, and the following verses. The Holy Spirit spoke that cloven tongue language that goes out in every language of the world. That's who was there, people from all over the world, and they understood down even to the very dialect or accent of the county in which they were born. Not only were they speaking English, if you were an Irishman, you would hear it with an Irish brogue. If you were from Brooklyn, New York, you would hear it with a New York accent. If you were from Texas, you would hear it in a Texas accent. So that's the difference between speaking tongues that no one understands what's being said, and that's fake. And I know that offends a lot of people, but if you're raised believing and being taught that if you don't do this, you don't have the Holy Spirit, that causes a lot of anxiety among people, and it's false teaching. Evidence of the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit speaks through God's elect, when they're delivered up, it'll be in that same cloven tongue language that everyone will understand. Jim in Texas, I have heard you mention a couple of times that Cain survived the great flood. Actually, you've heard us say descendants of Cain, the Kenites, survived the great flood. You mentioned Genesis 7:1 and 7:13, and so on and so forth. And I'm just going to cut it short and say 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55 proves without any shadow of a doubt that descendants of Cain, the Kenites, survived the flood of Noah's time. That was centuries there in 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55, centuries after the flood of Noah's time. Terry in Tennessee, I believe this is, the 5 month period will be, will it be broken down into some months with the Antichrist before the final months with Christ? I think you're misunderstanding something. The tribulation of Antichrist, the 5 month period covered in Revelation chapter 9, will have 2.5 months. The first 2.5 months will be under the one world political beast system of Revelation 13. It receives the deadly wound, and then Pretty Boy Floyd, the Antichrist, shows up to save the day for 2.5 months. At the end of that period is when Christ returns as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Jason in Maryland, what does perdition mean? And in the Greek language, it's one of Satan's names, I hope you recognize, Apollyia. And it is means destruction. It is also translated that very word into the King James Version Bible as perish. There is only one son of perdition as listed in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. He is none other than Satan. Satan is the only one who is sentenced to die and to be turned to ashes from within, to perish in the lake of fire that you can read about in Ezekiel chapter 28, verse 18 and 19. I'm out of time. I want you to know that I love you a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying God's word in depth. And you know what? It makes God's day when he looks down from heaven and he sees you studying the letter that he wrote to you. It makes his day. Blessings always follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. Most important, though, beloved, is this. You stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you. The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the mark of the beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the mark of the beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13 verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13:23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word? Remember the subject? Authority. We covered kind of the first phase of it in the last lecture. And if I may, I want to recount to you the closing thought was Christ's message, his commission to the people, go unto the world and teach my word. And we found that our Father had placed